go. Welcome, everyone. My name is Sarah Ray from the Bloomfield Public Library. Thank you for joining us for our last opera talk of the season, Magic Flute. I'm going to turn this over to Jeffrey.
Oh, thank you, Sarah, and welcome to Die Zauberflöte. So that's the beginning of the overture, and as you could tell, it begins with three chords. And the number three is very important in this opera because it is, I believe, I haven't been able to find another one, the first Masonic opera. And very important number to the Freemasons would be the number three. It represents the world of men. The number five represents the world of women. And there's an awful lot of symbolism connected to the rituals of the Freemasonry, which we'll get to a little bit later, but I'll probably forget. So let me just begin by saying that Mozart would in fact write this opera in the key of E flat major, which has three flats. And you have groups of women in threes. You have the three ladies in waiting to the Queen of the Night. You have three boys that are going to take our two heroes to the Brotherhood of Sodasto. In Act Two, you have Sodasto coming on scene with 18 priests, of course, can be divided by three, and they sit in 18 chairs. So you've got these symbols all through the opera. But I first want to take a look at the year in which the Magic Flute was composed, last year of Mozart's life, which was it wasn't an easy year for him, but despite many difficulties, he was quite productive in writing some of his finest music. And we can begin by January 5th. He's composed his last piano concerto, number 27, which is a wonderful work. In April, he's going to write his last string quintet, another very fine work. That is his last purely instrumental work. In June, we have the Ave Verum Corpus, which is a very popular short motet religious piece. Popular today. And then he ends with two operas, Magic Flute and La Clemenza di Tito, and just after them his clarinet concerto, which is a very fine concerto. And on top of that, he's going to begin his Requiem, which sadly has to leave unfinished. And it's going to be completed by a pupil of his named Sussmayr, who actually Mozart would have preferred someone else to finish it. He, in his own words, considers Sussmayr an ass. And yet Sussmayr, while Mozart was in quite ill health at the end of the year, would work together with him on the Requiem, would play passages for him or sing passages. And so he had a very good understanding of what Mozart wanted to do with it. There is only one segment, the introduction, the Requiem Introitus, I think it's called, which is the only fully scored part of the work by Mozart. The rest was put together through various sketches by Sussmayr. So, very productive musical year, but there were other difficulties. And one, of course, was health. And Mozart throughout his life, and I think I talked about this when we discussed Don Giovanni, was suffering from ill health throughout his life. Back at the age of 13, he had had smallpox. He had bouts of rheumatic fever. And those last couple months, well, first of all, he was thoroughly exhausted because of all of this compositional work. He worked literally night and day. and exhaustion would contribute to his death. But on top of that, he had a renal failure, he had another bout of rheumatic fever, a whole list of things, actually. I was running down the list. I never heard of some of these medical problems, so I won't even attempt to list them or discuss them. But he was not in good shape. And by November 5th, he put his pen down and still had another month to live, but he was simply too exhausted and in such poor health that he couldn't compose anymore. So there was the ill health. And then there was a question of financial woes. And I think this has become a myth that Mozart was a poverty-stricken composer. He never was. Again, as I had said in Don Giovanni, by the mid-1780s, he was immensely popular, immensely successful. But then his fortunes are going to be on the downturn. Part of it was that his subscription concerts he'd been organizing, meaning that he would set a date, he would perform, he would conduct a symphony, play a concerto, and he would get these concerts funded by subscriptions by the aristocracy, by the imperial family. But he's going to lose the support. There was some type of an economic downturn in Austria. The aristocracy had to hold back on contributing to concerts, certainly not to large-scale concerts like for symphonic music. They're going to downsize to chamber music. And these subscription concerts are going to come to an end by the end of the 1780s. So this was an important source of income for him. On top of that, he had his daily expenses. Now, he wasn't an extravagant spender, but he did have to maintain a certain look and would have to wear fine clothes. Not the most expensive and fashionable, but he had to be decently dressed because he would appear at court. And this would, of course, cost money. He did like fine clothes. He loved, lace and watch chains. He was fanatical about his hair. His hairdresser would come every morning and wake him up at 6 o'clock and do his hair so that by 7, he could start composing. And you can see Mozart there in the red coat. That doesn't look anything like him. He was not very attractive looking. As I said, from smallpox, he had pock marks all over his face. But you do see his hair looking at least very good. And he did take great care with it. So there was the question of family expenses. He wasn't a very good bookkeeper, nor was his wife Constanza. Though, miracle of miracles, after his death, she becomes like an unofficial CPA and manages very well his affairs, sells his music to publishers, organizes concerts, was a singer, so she would even perform in some of them, and would make quite a bit of money so that when she dies very, very comfortably. Now, there is a story about Mozart being buried in a grave for the poor, but that was only because she was advised by friends, because at this time her finances weren't very good. She wasn't starving, though, but they said she could have saved money if she put him in a pauper cemetery, which she would, and that's why today we have no idea where he's buried. Constanza also was costing him a lot of money because she was always pregnant. Now, they get married in 1782 and immediately have a first child. In 83, there would be 6 children altogether, but only 2 would survive. And apparently there were some miscarriages as well. So from 1783 to 1791, that's when she has her last child, she was constantly pregnant. And after she would have the child, she would go for recovery to Baden-Baden for the spa waters. And that, of course, would be very costly. So he would have to borrow money. And he would, in fact, from one of his Freemason brothers, a Johann Puchberg, who was a great admirer of his, and helped him out a lot. And there are a lot of letters remaining of Mozart writing to Puffberg and begging him for more funds. Some of these loans were paid back before his death, and after his death, Puchberg knew that Constanze was in financial trouble and would lend her money, but she would pay all the debts back. You know, unlike Richard Wagner, who borrowed from everybody and never paid a cent or a pfennig back to anybody. So it's not an easy year, but despite that, very similar to Schubert, who was so ill the last months of his life and was producing masterpiece after masterpiece, well, you have the same with Mozart. Now, we have this question of Freemasonry. And Mozart was a Freemason, becomes one at the end of 1784. Haydn follows him a couple months later. And part of the Freemasons was, of their tenets, were to be helpful to others, and certainly within their own society. And very important to them were the ideas of freedom, of tolerance, what do you call them, leaving out a couple, of course, liberty and equality. And that's why Puffberg and others were willing to support Mozart. A little history of the Freemasons. Some date them back to ancient Egyptian times, but most experts tend to focus on the 14th century and focus on England and Scotland. And you had, of course, stonemasons. And in large cities, they would help to build castles and cathedrals. And they would establish guilds, like so many artisans would in those days. And the guilds were kind of the forerunners of labor unions today. They would protect their workers to a certain extent and help them find work. And the remote areas didn't have guilds, so these stonemasons would set up lodges. And these lodges were places where they could go and rest. They might be able to get a drink or maybe some food. But most importantly, they could talk, and they didn't have to worry about what they were saying. It's kind of like that Las Vegas saying, what you do in Vegas stays in Vegas. Well, what you talked about in a lodge stayed in the lodge. So you could criticize your employers and criticize working conditions, but it never left the lodge. And these stonemasons who become Freemasons are going to spread. You'll get them into German states by the 15th century. In 1717, we have the first lodge set up in London, and in 1730 in Boston and Philadelphia. And the first ones, 1742, are in Austria, apparently short-lived in Austria. Emperor, this will be Francis II, is going to ban them or shut them down. And in part because this was a rather democratic view of life. And you might say they had ideas similar to those being expressed during the French Revolution. And the last thing that Francis II wanted was a French Revolution in Austria, keeping in mind the French Revolution was 1789. So he's going to ban them officially in 1795, but it didn't really matter because they were tending to fizzle out by 1794, at least in Austria. Apparently today the Freemasons are still the largest fraternal society in the world. I just looked up on Wikipedia, which is a no-no usually in my books, but I was curious if they can't have a comeback in Austria. Found no mention of Austria. They are active in the United States and England. And when I lived in Paris back in the 1970s and 80s, they were very much around in France. I would think that they're still around. And my father was a Freemason, but he would never talk about it. Well, it's part of being a Freemason. You're not allowed to. I even asked him, oh, show me at least one secret handshake, and he wouldn't. And I told him what the French Freemasons were like. In France, It wasn't just a fraternal society. It was a society that if you were a member, you could use it to get into very favorable positions. For instance, I remember you would come across, oh, a conductor who was a nincompoop, and you just wondered, how in the world did he become the conductor of this very good orchestra, maybe a French orchestra? Well, actually, it's not true because the French don't have very good orchestras, but what would be a decent orchestra? And the expression was always the same. Ah, il est franc-maçon. He's a Freemason. And I did a little research when I was there, and I was amazed at how many musicians, and not very good musicians, were Freemasons, and I would give credence to this. I mentioned it to my father, who said, no, that's not what the Freemasons about. Well, maybe not the American Freemasons, but certainly the French Freemasons were, and maybe still are today. Anyway, so much for that. So Mozart is going to hook up, so to speak, with one Emmanuel Schikaneder, who, if he is forgotten, he should be at least remembered for his name. It's a wonderful name. Who was also a Freemason, not from Austria, but from he joined a lodge in Regensburg in Bavaria, and he's going to be the librettist and the sort of the sponsor of this opera. So, a few words about him. Be nice to remember him. He's born in 1751 in Straubing, which is in Bavaria, kind of between Munich and Regensburg, but a little bit closer to Regensburg. Of a poor family, his mother and father are both servants. Five children, he'll be the fourth. When he's 3 years old, his father passes away and the mother settles in Regensburg. And he's going to enter into a Jesuit gymnasium. If you recall, the gymnasium was a German type of school that placed great emphasis on classical language, Latin and Greek, kind of a glorified high school. And he would study music, played violin, would join the boys' choir, and of course would have to leave when his voice changed. And he developed into apparently a very good baritone singer. And in the end, he developed into this sort of all-round theatrical person, an operatic person. He was a singer, he was a composer, he was a librettist, he was a playwright, he was a director of plays, of theaters. And after leaving gymnasium, well, that's not what he's going to be doing. He's going to become a minstrel, wandering minstrel from town to town. And he sings for his bread and holds out his hat and collect some money. We'll sleep in cheap inns or in barns. And he's doing this till 1773. Now he's 22, when there's a revelation, a life-shattering experience. He attends a performance of an itinerant theatrical company, the Franz Josef Moser Group, and decides, this is what I want to be. I want to be in the theater. Beginning as a player, and he joins the troupe. And he'll stay with them for a short while, then he'll change and go to another itinerant group called the Andreas Schopf Group. And here he meets his wife to be. This was Eleonora Arth, Arth. Different descriptions of her, probably coming from different points in her life. One that she was very attractive, which probably came when she was youthful. Probably a later one will be the one that states that she was very fat and cross-eyed. But they do get married, and this will be in 1777. And this is not a good marriage, not because of her, but because of him. He's extremely unfaithful, and in the span of 3 years has three illegitimate children. And eventually she leaves him and with his best friend and colleague, Johann Friedel, and will act in his troupe. But eventually she will come back to Schikaneder. Meanwhile, Schikaneder is going to return to the Moser group. And in 1779, Moser, who had just lost his wife, is rather depressed and getting older and decides he's going to retire. And he gives the troupe over to Schikaneder. And he brings it to Salzburg. He's mainly circulating in Bavaria, Upper Austria, sometime branches off to the Czech part of Austria, to Pressburg, which is now Bratislava, or to Pest, which is now Budapest, of course, in the Hungarian part. But he's going to come to Salzburg and we'll put on a season of performances for 6 months. And here he meets Mozart. Mozart's still there with his father, only comes to Vienna in May of 1781. And becomes friendly with the family, gives them complimentary tickets for the season. And he was a real populist. He would sort of cater to the demands of the public. It was a rather amusing example of this. There was a play by a Herr Turping called Agnes Bernauerin, very hard to pronounce. And it was based on a historical episode. This is in the early 15th century. You had a Duke Albrecht II who falls in love with a commoner, Agnes Bernauerin, and he marries her. Now, his father, the former Duke, Duke Ernst, was very upset, tried to convince him to abandon his wife. He refused, and so the father had her drowned in the Danube. Now, in the play, it's not the father who drowns her, but the Grand Vizier, who apparently was a real nats of work in the play. And to the point that he was getting booed and hissed during the performance, and even outside of the theater, the poor actor, if he was found by an audience member in an inn or walking the street, would be cursed at. Someone actually came after him with a dagger. And Schikaneder heard about this, and so at the beginning of one performance, he said, and this evening, the Grand Vizier is going to be pushed off a bridge. And during the performance, sure enough, he was pushed off a bridge into the Danube and died, and everybody cheered. Kind of reminds me of a film I saw back in Paris. It was in 1984. It was called Lady Hawk. It wasn't a bad film. It was actually a good film with a terrible musical score, which made it kind of a bad film. But it was about this evil archbishop who's just so unpleasant. And he was played by a wonderful English actor, John Wood. And at the end, he is killed. And the reaction of the audience, this is just for a film, the place erupted in cheers. So overwhelmingly evil he'd been for 2 hours, and he was finally gone. So he had the same thing with Schikaneder in this play. So he has great success in Salzburg. He was supported by the Archbishop Coloredo, who was the tormentor of Mozart and the reason why Mozart left Salzburg for Vienna. And after that, he's again on the road here and there, again in the same area of Bavaria, Austria. And in 1783, makes his debut in Vienna at the Kärntner Theater. And then he's going to be heard by Emperor Joseph II. This is the son of Maria Theresa. And he's going to attend a performance of Schikaneder's in Pest, and then invites him back to Vienna and hands over control of the Kärntner Theater. And he does a season of 3 months, but is not very successful. So he goes on to be a player in the National Theater for a year. Then we switch back to Eleonora and Johann Friedel. Now in 1786, we have a theater rebuilt. I don't know what was there beforehand. Remember I said last week that the Burgtheater was a tennis court converted into a theater. All that is mentioned is that this theater was rebuilt in a Freihaus, which was just outside of the Vienna walls, on an island. This is a little bit confusing. Not in the Danube or the Danau Canal, which is a semicircle coming off the Danube so that it comes right up to the city limits. The Danube doesn't. But there was another river called the Wien River, the Vienna River. And this little community grew up next, what called the Freihaus, meaning free house, because they didn't have to pay taxes. And along with the theater, this little community had its own church, its own mill, its own pharmacy, lots of artisan shops, 32 stairways, 6 courtyards, one large courtyard next to the theater. And The theater is going to be taken over or offered to Johann Friedel in 1788, and he's going to run it jointly with Eleonora. But he passes away in 1789, and she asks Schikaneder, who's already had great experience directing theaters, to direct it jointly with her, which he'll do. And this will be the Freihaus Theater an der Wien. And people, which makes it a decent sized theater, had an orchestra of about 35 players, which was the norm. The Burgtheater had about 40. And he is going to approach Mozart to write an opera together with him, and he'll be the librettist. And that, of course, is going to be Zauberflöte. And Schikaneder even creates a role for himself in the opera, which will be Papageno, a nice comic role. So most of the opera is completed by July of 1791. There's still the overture and a march that needs to be completed. In the meanwhile, that same month, he is going to be commissioned to write the Requiem and also to write an opera for the coronation of Leopold II. So we have Maria Theresa, her son Joseph II. I guess Leopold was also a son. Joseph dies in 1790, so Leopold assumes the throne. And he only reigns for 2 years. He passes away, and that's when we get Francis II, who will be the last Holy Roman Emperor. And for the coronation of Leopold, there was first the coronation as Emperor of Austria in 1790 in Frankfurt. But then we have him being crowned the King of Bohemia, and that'll take place September 6th of 1791 in Prague. And it's not the emperor, who didn't care for Mozart, nor his music or music in general, but it'll be the impresario of the National Theater in Prague, which, if you recall from last week, Don Giovanni, had commissioned Mozart to compose an opera, Don Giovanni, for the theater, now commissions him for another opera, which would be La Clemenza di Tito. And that's going to be premiered on September 6th. It will not be very successful. In fact, the Empress will refer to it as a porcheria schweininen, meaning swinish pigsty, or, yeah, swinish pigsty, sort of. And her comments circulated, which, you know, obviously kept people away from from performances. And the last performance will be given on September 30th, the same night as the first performance of Zauberflöte, and for some reason, that performance was a triumph. But that opera is going to virtually disappear until we get into, well, the 20th century. Magic Flute, on the other hand, is going to be very successful, and it's going to get some 24 performances between September 30th and the beginning of November. And poor Mozart doesn't live to see the great success of it. By 1800, it's had some 200 performances at that one theater alone. Meanwhile, it is being performed outside of Austria and is one of the few operas of Verdi that really survived the 19th century. Don Giovanni is one, and Marriage of Figaro, though I don't get numbers for Le Nozze, but it was certainly well known amongst composers. How many performances it got or how well it was in the repertory, I'm a little uncertain. But keep in mind that Mozart that we know today was not the Mozart of the 19th century. He's really, like Bach, discovered after World War II. And then all of his music is going to start to surface and be recorded, and he becomes mostly Mozart and all that. So in the 19th century, you have two or three of his operas being performed here and there. The symphonies are not heard that often, the concerti not that often, and of course chamber music isn't really that popular until we get to the mid-19th century. So we go to the opera itself, and I don't think I'll play the overture, I won't have time. I'll play a number of excerpts and go through the plot, which, like all plots, confuses me terribly. So we start in Act One, and we come across a gentleman named Prince Tamino. And he's a very heroic figure. He's being chased by a dragon, and in heroic style, he faints. Well, coming onto the scene are three ladies, three, and they are the courtesans or court ladies of the Queen of the Night. And they slay the dragon and then they leave. Well, now coming onto the scene is a gentleman named Papageno. He's a bird catcher and he's dressed like a bird. He looks like a bird, he talks like a bird, but he ain't a bird. And he awakens Tamino and brags that he slew the dragon. Well, three ladies come and they get very angry with him because he's always telling tall tales, and they put a padlock on his mouth. And he has to kind of sing an aria with his padlock on. So he's singing, while Tamino and the three ladies are singing. Well, actually, won't listen to that excerpt. But we will listen to his opening aria, which is just a delight. And in this opera, Mozart uses diverse styles of music. With Papageno and his girlfriend, who comes later on, Papageno, their arias are like folk tunes, very hummable, very memorable. You're going to have an actual Lutheran hymn used by Mozart in the opera. You have two coloratura arias for a very high soprano. It's tautologous, but in case you don't know what coloratura means, it means high tessitura. So you have quite a variety here, and we'll start with the folk-like material. This is Papageno being sung by Hermann Pry, and I'm going to be jumping back and forth between two recordings because half my favorite singers are on one and the other half are on the other. And so this is the Georg Schulte recording with Hermann Pry. Hermann Pry was a wonderful baritone, wonderful in comic roles, though he could also sing serious ones. He was terrific as Figaro in The Barber of Seville. And here is opening aria, which is Ich bin der Vogelfänger. Ein Vogelfänger bin ich ja. The Vogel, the birdcatcher, I am. Something of the sort.
Wären mein, so tauschte ich brav Zucker ein, dem welche mir am liebsten wär, der gäb ich gleich die Zucker her. Und küsste sie mich zärtlich dann, wär sie mein Weib und ich ihr Mann. Sie schlief an meiner Seite ein, ich wiegte wie ein Kind sie ein.
Now, of course, he comes with his pipe, sort of the Zamfir of the forest. And eventually the padlock is taken off, and the three ladies bring in their mistress, the evil queen of the night. And apparently there was also some symbolism in these characters. The queen of the night might have been representing Maria Teresa, who was rather despotic, and that Sarastro, the high priest, who we'll meet later on, was more like Joseph II, because he was considered a reformer and a wise ruler. Anyway, the queen of the night comes, and she tells Tamino that she's got a beautiful daughter named Pamina, who's been kidnapped by the evil Sarastro, and she would like him to go and and save her. Shows a portrait of her to Tamino, who of course falls in love with her immediately and agrees to help out. So he's given a magic flute to protect him, and Papageno is given a magic set of bells, and then three boys come to lead them to the realm of Sarastro. Well, this is the first of the two great arias for the Queen of the Night. And singing this is the one and only Edita Grubarova. And I'm so pleased. Yesterday I was driving to Cedar Mountain, a retirement community, to do the flute. And I was listening to Sirius Radio. And they have a Metropolitan Opera channel, for those of you who don't know. And it's wonderful. They play old performances, date of 30. And oh, lately, last couple months have really been boring. Massenet and Carmen and every opera you don't want to hear, Tales of Hoffman. And yesterday, they played I Puritani, The Puritans by Bellini, which is a wonderful work. And it was brought back to life by Joan Sutherland and her husband, Richard Bonning. And she'd retired, and then they obviously brought in other sopranos, and Gruborova sang this in 1991 at the Met. And I remember seeing a review by the then critic, Donald Henahan, who replaced Harold C. Schoenberg, and who should never have been hired. He should have been fired before he was hired, in my opinion. And he gave her a terrible review, so I was really very curious to see what this sounded like. And I have to admit, at the beginning, she might have been a little tentative. And who knows if this was the same performance that he reviewed? Probably not. But then she was simply incredible. And what was so nice is that at the end of her arias, both arias that I heard, she got this incredible ovation from the audience. So old Henahan, who didn't know the difference between a good singer and a bad singer, compare that to an audience that actually knew what they were listening to. And it was sort of made my day. Anyway, here she's singing her first aria, which goes up into the upper stratosphere for soprano. Number four.
Thank you.
can get a sense through the Zoom of what spectacular singing this is. It's so nice to have a singer who can sing not only loud, but can also sing a true pianissimo. And this extraordinary technique that she had. Well, we've got one more aria to go for her a little bit later. So we have somehow Tamino and Papageno get separated. And it's Papageno that finds Pamina first. And he tells her about Tamino, and without a portrait of him, she falls in love with him, and they're talking about escaping, but they're intercepted by a figure called the Monostatos. And he's a slave belonging to Sarastro. And here's kind of one strange thing. In Sarastro, who is supposed to represent sort of the head of the Freemasons in the opera, is supposed to be wise, and the Freemasons who believe in equality and tolerance and justice and freedom, and yet he owns slaves, which doesn't quite make sense. Anyway, you have Papageno, who takes out his magic bells and plays a cute little tune, and the Modestados and his slave colleagues go dancing off in very campy fashion. So we'll play sort of a little duet between Papageno and Pamino, and then you'll hear the Monostatos, who's sung by Gerhard Stolz, who's not a household name. He was a wonderful character tenor. I had a chance to meet him back in the days, oh gosh, I guess I was in college. I had this brilliant idea of trying to interview him and writing an article and getting it published in Opera News. And he was very nice. He came to New York. He was singing in the ring. And I got to interview him. He was terribly nice. He didn't speak much English, so I don't know how he communicated. My bad German, his bad English. And, of course, the interview was never published. But when I was living in Paris, he looked me up, and we went out for a beer together. I didn't drink beer, but he had beer. And he was a terribly nice man, died much too young, but specialized in these character roles. And often you get these sort of character tenors who push and have a wide vibrato, but he had a wonderfully well-focused voice. You don't call it beautiful, but it was a nice voice, and he was a terrific actor on stage. As Herod, he was absolute nutcase in Salome. So anyway, you'll hear Gerhard Stolz in number 7.
Spinne Füße, raschste Mund, Stück Wein, das Leben ist tot. Finde mir Tamino noch, sonst erwischen sie uns noch. Finde mir Tamino noch, sonst erwischen sie uns noch. Stille, 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 ich kann's besser.
Das klingt so herrlich, das klingt so schön. La 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 la. Wie hab ich so etwas gehört und gesehen? La 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 la. Wie hab ich so etwas gehört und gesehen? La la la.
So eventually you're going to have Tamino and Papageno meeting Sarasto, and he advises them to go to the Temple of Examination. So they're going to have to pass certain rituals to become part of the Brotherhood. So we're in Act 2, and the first ritual is that of silence, and Tamino and Papageno are not allowed to speak. Oh, I skipped an excerpt. I'm going to backtrack. And we do have this one unpleasant scene. We might as well get rid of it and get over it. Where the Monostatos is going to attempt, I'm not going to use the R word, but attempt to seduce Pamina. And reading the libretto, I was quite shocked by what he's singing. I'll read you the text. I'm kind of surprised that in today's era this would go well unnoticed. He sings, "All may feel the joys of love, trifle, flirt, fondle, and kiss, and I must abstain from love because a black face is ugly. Is no heart given to me? Am I not of flesh and blood? To live forever without a wife would be indeed to burn in hell. Therefore, while I am alive, I shall flirt, kiss, and be loving. Dear good moon, forgive me, I feel love for a white woman. White is beautiful, I have to kiss it. Moon, hide a while, and if it is too much for you to see, then close your eyes." Now, it's a nice little aria, it only lasts about a minute and 14 seconds, but most people probably aren't aware of what he's singing. But again, this is Gerhard Stolz, that's the main reason I'm playing it. Brings back fond memories. And, of course, he doesn't. Pamina is saved.
Alles in der Liebe, Freude, Schäme, Tände, Herz und Brust. Und ich soll die Liebe meiden, weil ein Schwarz hässlich ist, weil ein Schwarz hässlich ist. Ist mir denn kein Herz gegeben? Bin ich nicht von Fleisch und Blut, bin ich nicht von Fleisch und Blut. Im ohne Weibchen leben wäre wahrlich Höllenblut, wäre wahrlich Höllenblut, wäre wahrlich Höllenblut. Drum so will ich, weil ich lebe, schnäbeln, küssen, zärtlich sein. Lieber guter Mond, vergebe, eine Weiße nahm ich ein, eine Weiße nahm ich ein. Weiß ist schön, man muss es küssen. Mond, verstecke dich dazu. Mond, verstecke dich dazu. Sollte es sich zu sehr verdrießen, oh, so mach die Augen zu. Oh, so mach die Augen zu. Oh, so mach die Augen.
So, now we go back to the trials of Tamino and Papageno. And, as I said, there's the moment where they're not allowed to talk. And Tamino is very good, keeps his mouth closed. Papageno can't stop talking. And at one point, this elderly hag comes up and I'm your intended. And Papageno's kind of aghast. He's looking for a Papagena and kind of dismisses her. And she goes away and then she comes back and she insists that she is going to be his Papagena. And in the end, he caves in and says, well, if it must be, it shall be. And he is going to say, okay, I will marry you. And then she's instantly transformed into a Papagena. And then she's taken away from him. And of course, he's very, very upset. We're going to have the Queen of the Night, I think I'm going out of order here, who is going to approach Tamino I'm sorry, she comes to approach Pimina, and this is when she sings her second aria, and here she's really in a fury, and she's singing about the revenge of hell. And again, this is a very difficult aria, and the nice thing about the way Gruberova sings it is that when she hits these high notes, there's substance to them. They're not little squeaks. I mean, there are lots of singers that can sing these arias, but there's no texture to their sound. It's like a little squeak box. But with her, it's a beautiful note, even if it's a high F. And so this is the famous Hölle Rache, Revenge of Hell. And once again, with Gruberova. Sorry, I'm all over the place today. Oh, and I've done it again. It's the wrong recording. Sorry. We're going to hear the Queen of the Night, who is not very good. She takes slower tempi when she has to hit the difficult bits, kind of like Paderewski, the pianist. He was famous for slowing down when passages got difficult on the piano, and then he would speed up when it was easier. She's doing the same thing. Christine Deutikum. But this is the Gruberova. Papageno and Tamino. Tamino's faring well. He's going to be joined by Pimina, and they're going to have to go through these rituals of fire, earth, air, and water. They're being purified, so they're the brotherhood, or at least he can. And he's protected, of course, by the magic flute. Meanwhile, Papageno is very depressed because he's lost his Papagena, and he's thinking of committing suicide and puts together a noose on a limb. And when the three boys appear and tell them, "You've forgotten the magic bell. Play the magic bells and you might be surprised." And he does, and Papagena appears. Again, a wonderful little folk tune. And you've got, I think this is the celesta, not a glockenspiel. I think today they use a celesta, but who knows, it might be a glockenspiel. A wonderful tune by number 15, Papageno.
Fürsten nicht messen, des Lebens als Weiser nicht freuen und wie im Elysium sein. Dann könnt ich mit Fürsten mich messen, des Lebens als Weiser nicht freuen. Keiner von allen den reizenden Mädchen gefallen. Hilf eine mir nur aus der Not, sonst gräb ich mich wahrlich zu Tod. Ach, kann ich denn keiner gefallen? Hilf eine mir nur aus der Not, sonst gräb ich mich wahrlich zu Tod. Mich wahrlich zu Tod. Mich wahrlich zu Tod.
Then, of of course, we have, finally, Papageno meeting Papagena, and they have this charming little duet. Tamino is able to pass all of the trials, and he gets Pamina. And we still have the Queen of the Night, though. And she's going to make a final attempt to destroy Sarastro and assault his temple. And so she now, the Monastatos has switched sides and is working with her. But they are repelled by the forces of lightning and light and all that. And the opera ends very happily, and she is defeated. But I will play the attempted assault by the Queen of the Night, again with Gerhard Stoltz. Different Queen of the Night, this is with Christine Deutekom.
Stille, 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 bald dringen wir im Tempel ein.
Nur stille, 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 bald dringen wir im Tempel ein.
Doch Fürstin, alte Wort, erfülle, dein Kind muss mein Begatten sein.
Von dir ist, ist alles nur noch echt und still. Ihr große Königin der Macht.
And so, despite that, we have a happy ending. And that concludes today's last opera,